89.7 is proud to present It's a Wonderful Life, produced by the Northumberland Players, recorded live at the Fire Hall Theater on December 5th, 2013.
Watch out, you better not cry, you better not pout, I'm telling you why.
Why?
Santa Claus is coming to town, gather round. He's making a list, checking it twice, he's gonna find out who's naughty and nice. Santa Claus is coming to town.
He sees you when you're sleeping, he knows when you're away.
He knows if you've been bad or good, so
be good for goodness sake.
You better watch out, you better not cry, you better not pout, I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town.
Oh, hello there, good evening, and welcome to the Small Town Radio Theater presentation of It's a Wonderful Life. We're running just a little bit late today. Yes, aren't we all this time of year? Where does the time go? Before you know it, it will be 1947. Now, of course, we want you to laugh and enjoy yourself as much as you'd like. We want to hear that. It makes us do a much better job. But when we need your applause, you'll be given a cue from our sound effects artist here, Rob. When Rob gives you the signal, please applaud with gusto. Let's go. It seems like you guys already have it. We find that if you clap twice as fast, it conveys a feeling of exuberance and the light that goes out right over the airwaves. Let's rock demonstrate for them. Now you try it. Very good. You are an excellent studio audience. Okay, we'll be going on the air nationwide in just a moment, so please remove anything on your person that might make noise, such as buzzers, bells, field telephones, squeaky wheelchairs, noisy candy wrappers, firecrackers, bicycle horns. Thank you. Okay, now please enjoy being part of our live radio broadcast. In 5, 4... And now, a Small Town Radio Theater special presentation, brought to you by Asante Wealth Management. When you have Asante Wealth Management managing your money, you'll soon have more wealth than you can manage. And by Coburg Kia Motors. If buying an automobile is in your future, make it a Kia. Kia makes today's cars look like yesterday's news. Coburg Kia, service and dependability for today and tomorrow. And now it's time for the Small Town Radio Theater, starring Matt Kowalik, Colleen Lewis, Dave Clark, and Christine Stone, along with Anne-Marie Boutiette, Gary Potter, Sharon Rathbone, Jamie Spearman, and Neil Torrey. Also, sound effects artists Rob Howells and Stella Graff, and myself, Amber Mackey, in It's a Wonderful Life. But first, a word from our sponsor.
The Stitch Witch is here to help you. The Stitch Witch will help you see it through.
If you've got a project, big or small, the Stitch Witch has it all.
Sewing, quilting, machinery too. The Stitch Witch has got it all for you.
From notions to needles, patterns to pins, the Stitch Witch is where it all begins.
The Stitch Witch.
The Stitch Witch, open Monday through Saturday, 884 Division Street in Coburg.
And now, the Small Town Radio Theater presents It's a Wonderful Life. This is the story of George Bailey, an ordinary man who lives in Bedford Falls, New York. But George Bailey, more than anything, wanted to see the world, the exciting world that lay somewhere beyond his hometown. George had big dreams, but also big responsibilities. Of course, sometimes the two don't exactly fit together. Sometimes happiness is not over the rainbow, but right under your nose. However, our story doesn't begin in Bedford Falls. In fact, it doesn't begin anywhere in this world. It begins in heaven, where the superintendent of angels is briefing an apprentice angel named Clarence.
Clarence Oddbody, angel second class, reporting for duty, Your Honor.
What? They sent me an angel second class? You mean you haven't earned your wings yet?
No, not yet. But I'm hoping this mission will do the trick. Are you really sending me down to Earth? Gosh, I haven't been to Earth since that time when
you see, there's a man in trouble down there.
Good.
No, bad, Clarence. At precisely 10:45 p.m. Earth time, a man named George Bailey will be thinking about ending his life.
Ending his life? Oh, my. Well, I know that's bad.
Good, Clarence. Oh, I'm glad you understand. So you must stop him, if you can. Now, let me brief you about George Bailey's case history. You see, when George was a boy...
No, that's okay, Your Honor. All I need is a plan.
A plan?
You see, Your Honor, I'm reading The Adventures of Tom Sawyer, Mark Twain.
I'm familiar with the book.
Yeah, well, Tom Sawyer always has a plan.
I see. Well, if you can help George Bailey with your plan, Clarence, you just may get your wings. Say, how long have you been waiting for your wings anyway?
Over 200 years.
200 years? Oh, well, George Bailey is going to need a miracle.
Yes. Thank you for your confidence in me, boss. I'll leave immediately.
Wait, Clarence. Oh, plan or no, first, some background. Now, when George Bailey was a boy, he and his friends snuck onto old Mr. Potter's property and were sliding over a frozen pond on a shovel. But George's younger brother, Harry, fell through the ice.
And George jumped in to save Harry.
Yes, but as a result, George has a bad ear.
Sure, the icy water infection. I get it.
Now wait, Clarence. Look. A few months later, young George was working after school at Gower's drugstore. But on this particular day, Mr. Gower received a telegram informing him that his only son had just died of influenza. Devastated, Mr. Gower was trying to drown his sorrow in whiskey. Wow.
Gower's Drugs. Mrs. Blaine? What? Well, George should have delivered that medicine by now. Wait, here he comes. I'll send it right over. Goodbye. George, did you deliver that prescription?
Well, no, Mr. Gower.
Why didn't you deliver that right away? The little Blaine girl's sick. You lost it, didn't you?
No, Mr. Gower. Here it is.
Here? Why, you...
Oh, Mr. Gower, my ear, my ear.
Good for nothing, lazy loafer.
You're hurting my sore ear.
What are you trying to do? Ruin me?
Oh, no, Mr. Gower. You put something wrong in these pills.
Shut it up, you little...
Look, I know you're sad. You're upset about your son dying. You've been drinking, but you put something bad in these capsules. I didn't know what to do.
Huh? The capsules?
Look at them, Mr. Gower. You took the powder from this bottle. It's poison.
Poison? Poison? Oh, my God!
Don't hurt my sore ear again, please.
Poison? Oh, George.
That's why I didn't deliver the medicine, Mr. Gower. I wanted to ask my pop to make sure, but he was busy.
George, forgive me.
I won't ever tell a soul, Mr. Gower. I know you're sad. I won't ever tell anyone. Hope to die.
George.
The soda fountain that day. She heard it all, but she too never told a soul.
My, George sure took a beating, but he did the right thing.
Well, George grew up and he wanted to go to college, but there just wasn't enough money. So he worked 4 years at the Bailey Building and Loan Association.
Building and Loan?
Yes. George's father was in the building and loan business. He and George's Uncle Billy. But it was a case of high ideals and low bank account.
Oh, those two always seem to go together.
Anyway, George worked for his father and saved enough to pay for college, but first, he was going to summer in Europe, working his way across on a cattle boat. Full of wanderlust, George wanted to do a little traveling before college.
Well, you know, Pop, as good as Ma's apple pie is, and it's peachy for an apple pie, I've had enough. Gee, it's hard to believe this is my last night at the Old Bailey boarding house.
We're all gonna miss you, George.
Oh, I'm gonna miss you, Pop, and you, Mother, and everyone in Bedford Falls.
You've certainly earned your chance, son.
Oh, and I'm gonna take it. But hey, what's the matter, Pop? You look kinda tired.
I don't know. I had another run-in with Henry Potter today.
Oh, Mr. Potter, that old money-grubbing buzzard. I thought when you put him on the board of directors, he'd ease up on us a little.
So did I. He may be the richest man in town, but...
Well, the most miserable, if you ask me. I don't understand somebody like Mr. Potter. I mean, he can't begin to spend all the money he has.
Well, Potter's crippled. Spent his life in that wheelchair. He's frustrated. Think about it, George. If you were...
Oh, but Potter owns about everything he wants in town. Everything except the Bailey building and loan.
Maybe that's why he hates us. To him, we're just a bunch of...
Hey, fools. George, can I borrow your tuxedo cufflinks for tonight's dance?
Well, sure. Help yourself, Harry.
Well, where are they? Here in your suitcase?
Harry, George won't be needing a tuxedo on a cattle boat.
Well, you never know. Say, where'd you get that beat-up old suitcase anyway, George?
At the Emporium, Harry. Mr. Gower bought it for me.
Going away present?
Yep, far away. See, one of these days, that bag will be plastered with exotic travel stickers. You know, like Rome, Athens, Baghdad, Samarkand.
I guess you're gonna have a pretty full summer, George.
Oh, I'm gonna have a pretty full life.
So why don't you come to the dance tonight?
Your graduation dance? No, I'd be bored to death.
Oh, but what a wonderful death.
There'll be lots of pretty girls, son.
And we're using that new gym floor tonight.
That was a brilliant idea of yours, George. Putting the pool under the gym saved the high school thousands.
Well, Pop, that's just the start for me. You wait. Oh, what I'm gonna do? What I'm gonna see?
Like the tuxedo cufflinks?
I'll try upstairs, Harry, in my top drawer.
Okay, yikes. I gotta go. Bye.
Was I like that when I graduated from high school, Pop?
Pretty much. I sure wish we could send Harry to college with you, George.
Yeah, but Harry and I've got that all figured out. He'll take over my job at the building and loan, work and save for 4 years like I did, and then he'll go.
He's pretty young for that job.
Well, he's no younger than I was.
You were just born old, George.
So how's that, Pop? You know my trick here.
I said you were born old.
Well, then that's why I've got to hurry now. There's a whole world out there waiting for me to conquer it.
George, when you get out of college, you wouldn't consider coming back to the building and loan, would you?
What? Come back? Oh, no. Now, Pop, I just couldn't. I couldn't face being cooped up for the rest of my life in a shabby little office with all
I
those...
I see.
Oh, I'm sorry, Pop. I didn't mean that. But it's just this business of nickels and dimes.
I know. Spending your life trying to figure out how to save 3 cents on a length of pipe, I understand, son.
Do you, Pop? I mean, staying here, I'd just go crazy. See, I want to do something big, something important.
But in a small way, we are doing something important, George. In that shabby little office, we help people buy their own homes. We help their dreams come true.
I know, Pop, but most of my friends have already finished college. I feel if I didn't get away, well, I'd bust.
I guess you're right.
You know what I mean, don't you?
I know that this town's no place for anybody unless you crawl to Mr. Potter.
Well, that's not for me, Pop. Not that kind of life.
Yeah, you've got talent, George. A gift. So travel. Get yourself that education and do what you want, son.
You know, Pop, ready for a shock? I think you're a pretty great guy.
Well, thank you, George. Look, why don't you go over to Harry's dance? See that new gym floor over the pool. You'll have fun.
Well, it is my last night in Bedford Falls. I guess I could drop in, inspect the retracting floor, say goodbye to friends, maybe dance a bit. Maybe I will at that. Well, see you later.
Oh, George Bailey went to a dance. Is that important, boss?
Why, it was at that dance that he fell in the pool with Mary Hatch. And most of the rest of the graduating class of 1928.
Oh, so George and Mary went overboard at the dance, huh?
Later, he was walking her home. They've been feeling pretty good, Clarence. As a matter of fact, wonderful.
Buffalo gals, can't you come out tonight? And dance by the light of the moon.
Oh,
Hot dog, eh, Mary?
We sound beautiful, George.
Well, we don't look beautiful. You should have seen me scramble to get these dry clothes out of the locker room.
Well, I didn't know you were the football type.
Well, I didn't know you were the royal robe type.
Didn't you now? My train, sir.
Well, you're a caboose from a lady. Hey, you know something, Mary? I'd almost say you were the prettiest girl in town. I mean, you look wonderful.
Well, why don't you say it?
Well, I don't know. Maybe I will. What happened to you? How'd you get so grown up?
Well, I'm gaining on you, George. Maybe we'll be in the same class at college.
Same class? Hey, how old are you anyway?
18.
18? Seems only last year you were just, well, 17.
What? Am I too young or too old?
No. You're exactly right. Your age sort of fits you. I'm just saying you look a little older without your clothes on.
What?
No, I mean without your dress on. No, I mean...
What do you mean, George?
I mean, hey, look where we are.
Oh, the old Granville house.
Yeah, I gotta throw a rock. Bust a window.
Oh, no, George. Even though it's deserted, I love this old place. It's full of romance.
Romance? Now, with deserted houses, you make a wish and then you try to bust a window.
Oh, it's such a lovely old house. I want to live there someday.
In there? Go on. I wouldn't live there if I were a ghost. Now watch. That window on the second floor. Watch this. Here we go. How about that, huh? Pretty good shot. I broke that window.
What'd you wish for, George?
Wish? Oh, I don't know. Not just one wish, Mary. A whole hatful of them. See, I'm leaving this crummy little town. I want to see the world. Italy, Greece, the Parthenon, the Colosseum, and that's just this summer.
Well, that's a good start, George.
Yeah, and then I'm coming back and going to college to see what they know, of course.
Of course.
And then I'm going to build things. I'm going to build airfields and skyscrapers 100 stories high and bridges a mile long. And then I'm going to... What you doing, Mary? Hey, you're a pretty good shot yourself. So, what's your wish?
Oh, Buffalo gals, can't you come out tonight and dance by the light of the moon?
Oh, come on, Mary. What is it you want? Do you want the moon? All you gotta do is just say the word and I'll throw a lasso around it.
Okay, the moon. I'll take it. Then what?
Then what? Well, then you swallow it, and it dissolves, and moonbeams shoot out of your fingers and the ends of your hair, and then, do you think I'm talking too much?
Yes! Why don't you kiss her?
Well, how's that? Say what?
I said, why don't you just kiss her instead of talking her to death?
Well, kiss her, huh?
Youth is wasted on the wrong people.
Well, hey, just a minute. Hey, you come on back here. I'll show you some kissing that'll... Oh, wait, Mary, don't run off. I'm just funning with you. Oh, Mary, you're...
Over here in the hydrangeas.
What? In the hydrangeas?
Toss me my robe, George.
I'll toss you your robe, but sure, I'll just toss you... Now, wait a minute.
What?
Well, this is a very interesting situation.
Give me my robe, please.
Now, hold on. I've got to think this through. I mean, it isn't every day that a guy has an opportunity like this.
George Bailey.
Especially in Bedford Falls.
I'll tell your mother on you.
Oh, she lives way up the street from here.
George!
Maybe I could sell tickets. Make a little more spending money for the trip.
George!
Well, I'll tell you what. I'll make a deal with you, Mary, if you just let
George!
Me...
George!
Oh, hey, Uncle Billy, look here. I'm going to kiss Mary. Watch.
George, get in the car quick. It's your father.
Father?
He's had a stroke.
What? What? My father's
Come
had
Come on, George, get in. Hurry.
Oh, here, Mary, I've got to go.
Well, George's father died that night, Clarence. And George didn't go to Europe. But that fall, just as he was about to leave for college, the directors of the building and loan had a meeting.
A meeting?
They had to appoint a successor to Mr. Bailey.
These are good sound loans. I hope you'll just see them through me.
Enough discussion, gentlemen. All those in favor of approving these last loans made by our deceased president, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
No.
Mr. Potter's dissent is noted, but the motion carries. The loans are approved. Thank you, George. That's all we'll need you for. I hope I know you've got a train to catch.
Yes. Is there any taxi out there, Uncle Billy?
Yes, the taxi's waiting to take George to the train and college. Hurry, George.
I'd like the board to know that George here gave up his trip to Europe to oversee things these past months. Good luck to you at college, George.
Good luck, George.
Thank you. So long, gentlemen.
Now, proceeding with our agenda, we come to the real purpose of this meeting.
No.
It is now...
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Potter?
I've waited long enough. I want to get to my real purpose. The dissolution of this... I said I've waited long enough. Now, This institution isn't needed in this town. It competes with the bank and is a general nuisance to the sound business practices. Therefore...
What do you mean, the sound?
That is your opinion, Mr. Potter?
It's not an opinion, it's a fact. Now that Peter Bailey is dead, I move that we dissolve the building and loan and turn its assets and liabilities over to our receiver.
Now wait a minute, Potter.
No, you wait a minute. Peter Bailey was not a businessman. He was a man of high ideals, so-called, but ideals without common sense can ruin this town.
Ruin?
Of course. It isn't fair to the little people to encourage them to live beyond their means, like this Ernie Bishop, the taxi driver. I happen to know he was turned down for a home loan by the bank. But here...
Now, wait a minute, Mr. Potter. I handled Ernie Bishop's loan. You've got the papers in front of you, his income, insurance, his collateral, and I can personally vouch for his character.
Ah, a friend of yours, George. You see, gentlemen, if you shoot pool with an employee here, you can borrow money. And what's that getting us? A discontented, lazy rabble instead of a 50 working class. All because starry-eyed dreamers like Peter Bailey stir them up and put impossible ideas in their heads. Now, who will second my motion to dissolve?
Now, hold on, Mr. Potter.
Oh, I meant no disrespect, George, but your father...
Now, wait a minute. Why my father ever started this penny-ante building and loan, I'll never know. But just remember this, Mr. Potter. That rabble you're talking about, well, they do most of the working and paying and living and dying in this community.
So?
Well, is it too much to have them work and pay and live and die in a couple of decent rooms with a bath? Anyway, my father didn't think so. People were human beings to him, but to you, a warped, frustrated old man, they're cattle.
What?
In my book, Mr. Potter, my father died a richer man than you'll ever be.
I'm not interested in your book, George. I'm talking about the building and loan.
No, you're talking about something you can't get your greedy hands on, and it's galling you. That's what you're talking about. I've said too much. I have to leave.
That's okay, George. Come on.
That's quite enough, actually.
I apologize, gentlemen. Well, you're the board. You can do what you want. But let me just say that this town needs this measly one-horse institution. If only to have some place where people can borrow a few dollars without crawling to Mr. Potter. Come on, Uncle Billy. Let's get out of here.
So, what happened, George?
Yeah, all Tilly and I heard was a lot of yelling.
You won't believe it, Eunice. Boy, oh boy, you should have heard George.
Oh, yeah. Right now, they're voting us out of business.
Well, after 25 years, easy come, easy go. Of course, I don't know what's going to happen to us now.
And your mother, George, poor thing.
And no job for him.
But I don't care, George, because it was worth it. It was worth it to see you shut Potter's big mouth.
Yeah, who cares? I can get another job. I'm only 51.
56.
Well, you get out of here, George. You already missed your boat trip to Europe. Do you want to miss college, too?
Well, is Ernie still down?
George, they've just voted Potter down.
Whoopee, we're still in business.
What a relief, Tilly. There goes my new career, Eunice.
But there's one condition, George. They've appointed you to take your father's place.
Appoint me? No, Uncle Billy's your man.
Sure, you can keep him on. You can hire anyone you like.
Thanks, George.
No, wait, Dr. Campbell, get this straight. Don't you people realize I've got plans? I'm leaving for college right now.
George, you've got to take it. They'll vote with Potter otherwise. They said so.
Wait. Do you mean that without George here, Potter would be able to persuade them to dissolve the whole company?
Well, that can't be right, Dr. Campbell. Come on.
Wait, boss, don't tell me. George Bailey didn't make it to college.
No, we didn't, Clarence. George gave his college money to his brother, Harry. Harry went instead.
But what about that girl, the cute one, stuck in the hydrangea bush? Mary?
Oh, George saw her now and again. But Mary also went away to college. And George worked 4 more years at the building and loan, waiting for Harry to finish school, come back, and take over. George still hoped to see the world, though. He planned to work in the oil fields of Venezuela. But when Harry came back, he wasn't alone. There was a girl with him, his wife.
George, is that you, dear?
Oh, yes, Mother. I just thought I'd get some air.
So, how do you like your new sister-in-law?
Ruth? Oh, she's swell. Harry's got all the luck.
She'll keep him on his toes.
Well, keep him out of Bedford Falls anyway.
Now, Ruth's father has a good job for Harry up in Buffalo.
Yeah, Buffalo, and that means...
Oh, then you can't...
Yep, again.
I'm sorry, George.
Yeah.
Well, did you know Mary Hatch is back from college, too?
Yeah.
She's been back 3 whole days. Nice girl, that Mary.
I suppose.
Oh, stop this moping, George Bailey. It's not like you. Well,
what do you want me to do, Mother?
Give me one reason why you shouldn't go and see Mary.
Well, how about Sam Wainwright for one?
Sam Wainwright? Hee-haw? Well,
Sam's crazy about Mary.
Well, she's not crazy about him.
Not? Now, how do you know that? Was it in the newspaper? Did I miss it?
Mary's got her eye on you, George. She lights up like a firefly whenever she's around you.
A firefly?
You don't want her to be an old maid, do you? Plus, Sam Wainwright is in New York.
Oh, is he now? So all's fair in love and war, is that it?
Don't be difficult. The right girl can help you find the answers, George.
Okay, Mother. Trying to get rid of me, huh? Well, I think I'll go find a girl and do some passionate necking. Rawr!
Oh, George!
Good night, Mrs. Bailey. By the way, do you need any books from the library?
Library? George, you go and see Mary. Do you hear me?
Hey, George, you need a lift?
No, Arnie, I wouldn't want to rob you of a fare.
You wouldn't be robbing me of any fares, George. The taxi business is on the skids.
Well, then it's just like the building and loan business. Want to swap?
Actually, George, I need to talk with you. I'm going to have to turn the deed back over to you.
Deed? The deed to your house? You've only been there 2 years, Ernie.
Yeah, but with business being so bad, I can't make the payments right now. Me and the missus are just going to have to move back in with her folks.
Oh, Ernie, no. I'll tell you what, well, can you just pay the interest?
The interest? Well, sure, I could do that, but...
Okay, so keep the house. Forget the principal for a while. You're just hitting a rough patch, that's all.
Gosh, George, I don't know how to thank you. This means so much.
Hey, hear that? You're back in business, Ernie.
I am. Coming right up.
Attaboy, Ernie.
Hey, Georgie Porgy.
Oh.
Going somewhere?
Hello, Violet. Hi, fellas. Gosh, you look great, Vi.
And this old thing? I only wear this when I don't care how I look. Right, guys? Excuse me, fellas. I think I got a date. So, Georgie, what's going on? Where are you heading?
Oh, I was just going down to the library, I suppose.
Come on, Georgie. Don't you ever get tired of just reading about stuff?
Well, come to think of it, yes, okay. What are you doing tonight, Violet?
Me? Not a thing.
Okay. Well, if you're game, Vi, we can make a night of it. I've got to talk to somebody. What do you say?
Sure, George. It's about time. What'll we do?
What'll we do? Well, we'll go out to the fields. Yeah, take off our shoes and walk through the grass.
Fields?
Yeah, then we can go up to the falls. You've got to see them in the moonlight. And there's a green pool up there, Vi. We can swim in it.
Swim?
Sure, and then we can climb Mount Bedford and smell the pines and watch the sunrise on the peaks. Oh, come with me. We'll stay up there the whole night and be the talk of the town, and there'll be a terrific scandal. How about it, Vi?
George Bailey, have you lost your mind? Walk through the grass in my bare feet? It must be 10 miles to the falls, and this is all I have to wear. You expect me to go swimming in this?
Violet, okay.
What's with you, George? You know, for a guy who wanted to sail around the world, you sure don't seem to have been around the block. I mean, come on!
Well, fine. Just forget the whole thing. Forget it.
George? What are you doing out there?
Nothing. Uh-huh. is that you, Mary?
I think so. Well?
Well, what? Oh, me. I was just passing by.
Yes, several times. I was wondering if you were picketing or haunting me.
Oh, now why would I be...
But your mother phoned and said that you were coming over.
My mother? Phoned? Well, I just happened to be passing by, that's all. I didn't have any firm kind of...
So are you coming in or aren't you?
Well, All right, if you insist, I'll come in for a minute. But I didn't tell anybody I was coming here.
Right, you are your own man.
So when'd you get back?
Tuesday.
Huh. Where'd you get that dress?
New York. Do you like it?
Well, it's all right, I guess. Thought you'd take up in New York like Sam and the rest.
Oh, I worked there a few vacations, but I don't know, I got homesick.
Homesick? You got homesick for Bedford Falls?
Well, it is home after all. No point just standing here on the porch. Come on in.
Well, I don't understand this. I didn't tell anybody I was coming over here.
So you're leaving?
No, I wouldn't want to be rude. I'll stay a while since I'm here.
So it's nice about your brother and his new wife, isn't it?
Yeah, Ruth, it's okay.
What's the matter? You don't like her?
Well, of course I do. Ruth's a peach.
Oh, it's just marriage in general you're down on, then.
No. Marriage is all right for some people. I mean, it's fine for Harry, for Sam Wainwright, and you.
For Sam?
Mary? Who's down there?
It's George Bailey, Mother.
George Bailey? What's he want?
I don't know. George, what do you want?
Me? Nothing. Not a thing. I was just passing by.
Coward. He's making violent love to me, Mother.
He is? Well, you tell him to go right back home. Sam Wainwright said he'd call tonight from New York.
I guess so, Mother. So, George, how about a little music here?
You know, your mother shouldn't... Oh, that... Now, I didn't come over here just to...
Well, what did you come here for?
I don't know. You're supposed to be the girl with all the answers. How about you tell me why?
Well, why don't you just go home?
Okay, maybe I will go home.
Mary, the telephone!
She just still won't even know why I came here.
Mary!
Well, good night.
Good night.
Mary, the phone!
You know, with all this shouting, you think that maybe somebody could...
Mary, maybe it's Sam. Answer it!
You think what, George?
Mary, get the phone!
Already, I'll get it, Mother. Oh, George, on your way out, could you please turn off the phonograph?
Oh, sure, I'd be glad to. Doggone crazy song, let me out of here.
Hello, Hatch residence? Oh, Sam.
Hey, Mary, so good to hear your voice.
Is it?
Excuse me, Mary, seems I forgot my hat.
Oh, Sam, how nice of you to call all the way from New York. Hee-haw.
What? Mary? Oh, yeah, hee-haw.
You know, Sam, an old friend of yours is here, George Bailey.
What? Old Mossback George in person?
Yep, old Mossback George.
Oh, hee-haw, put old George on, I want to say hi.
Wait a minute, Sam. George!
Mary, you idiot! Sam doesn't want to talk to George.
He does, too. He even asked for George.
Now, what is it, Mary? You see, I'm in a hurry. I've got to get to the library.
Wait, it's Sam Wainwright. He wants to talk to you.
Well, Sam Wainwright, oh.
Sam, here's George.
Hi, Sam. Hee-haw.
Hee-haw! Some pal you are. What are you doing there, trying to steal my girl?
Steal your girl? Hey, nobody's trying to steal any girl. Mary, here's Sam again.
Wait a minute, George. Wait, I want to speak to both of you. Put Mary on the extension upstairs.
He wants you to get on the extension upstairs.
I can't. Mother's on the extension.
I am not.
George, just put your head a little closer. We can both hear.
Both? Okay.
There. All right. Sam, we're both on the line.
Good. Now, I have a plan that's going to make us all rich. George, remember one time in Mancini's Tavern, you told me about making plastics out of chili beans?
Chili beans?
Soya beans.
Oh, yeah, soybeans, okay.
Well, my father's investing in it, George. We're going to open up a factory outside of Rochester. What do you think of that?
Rochester? A factory? Wait, why don't you put it here in Bedford Falls? The old tool machinery works closed down. You could get that building for a song. Plus, there's lots of labor here, too.
Now you're talking, George. But here's the point. Mary, you listen to this, too. If you've got any money, put every dime into our stock.
Stock?
Come on, George. Might even have a job for you. That is, if you're still not married to that broken-down old building alone, here's your chance to get in on the ground floor.
Ground floor? That's wonderful.
We'll have to see, Sam.
Oh, Mary, are you still listening?
Yes, Sam, I'm here.
Tell George this is the chance of a lifetime, you hear? The chance of a lifetime.
He says it's the chance of a lifetime.
Well, give me that phone.
Here's George again. George!
Now you listen to me, Mary. I don't want any plastics, any job, any ground floors, and I don't want to get married ever to anyone. Do you understand me?
George!
I want to do what I want to do, and you're not going to trick me into any...
George!
hurt.
Oh, Mary, I...
I know.
So George and Mary got, what did they say, titch?
Oh, yes, Clarence, they were married that October.
Oh, I always cry in October.
And off they headed in their on their honeymoon in Ernie Bishop's taxi cab.
Here you go, newlyweds. I bet the cop sent this bottle of bubbly, but don't tell anyone. Prohibition and all that.
Mum's a word, Ernie.
So where are you two heading on this deluxe honeymoon?
Well, see this fat wad of cash? Count it, Mary. It's our kitty.
So?
So, we're shooting the works, Ernie. A week in New York, a week in Bermuda. It'll be the highest hotels, the richest caviar, the hottest music, and the prettiest wife.
Congratulations, Georgia. You're finally getting out of Bedford Falls. Then what?
Well, gee, I don't know. Then what, dear?
The moon. Who cares?
That's right. Hey, you know what, Mrs. Bailey? I haven't kissed you nearly enough.
Well then, come here, you.
Hey, slow down, lovebirds. Any fond farewells, George? Here's Genesee Street.
Oh, well, so long, Bedford Falls. So long, old building and loan. So long, Uncle Billy and Mr. Potter and everybody else. We're sneaking out and we won't be coming back ever.
Hey, George, there's something going on here. Look at that crowd. They're over there in front of the bank. It looks like the door's locked.
What? Pull over, Ernie.
What is it, George?
Hey, George, that's what you call a bank run.
A bank run?
Yeah, if you've got any money in that bank, you'd better go pull it out in a hurry.
George, no, let's not stop, please. Ernie, go straight to the train station. George?
Now, wait a minute, honey. I gotta see what this is. I'll be back in a sec.
No, George, please. George, don't go. Ernie, stop him.
We'll return in just a moment to the small town radio theater presentation of It's a Wonderful Life. And now, a word from our sponsors.
Hey, Georgie. Have you ever heard of NCPC?
Well, no, Violet, I have not.
It stands for Northumberland County Power Cooperative. This is a volunteer, not-for-profit organization, renewable energy cooperative owned by the community of Northumberland County.
Well, I'm impressed, Violet. What else can you tell me?
Oh, this is going to knock your socks off, Georgie. The NCPC aspires to build a legacy of safe, renewable energy for the county. They're planning to erect 3 rooftop photovoltaic projects on the Baltimore Rec Center, the 2 Coburg Arenas, and an industrial building by the railway station.
Wow, this sounds so futuristic.
Yeah. All this photovoltaic talk kind of makes you hot, doesn't it, Georgie?
Yes.
The Northumberland County Power Cooperative, making sunny days part of your future.
Mystic Roots will take care of you, your hair, face, and body too. Avita, Concept Salon and Spa, all you have to do is sit back and say, ah. Mystic Roots can make your dreams come true. What could be better than a whole new you? What'll they say when you walk through? Ooh, ah, ooh, la, la, la.
Mystic Roots Aveda Concept Salon and Spa, 287 Division Street, across from the United Church.
A legacy of safe, renewable energy for the county. They're planning to erect 3 rooftop photovoltaic projects on the Baltimore Rec Center, the 2 Coburg Arenas, and an industrial building by the railway station.
Wow, this sounds so futuristic.
Yeah. All this photovoltaic talk kind of makes you hot, doesn't it, Georgie?
Yes.
The Northumberland County Power Cooperative, making sunny days part of your future.
Mystic Roots will take care of you, your hair, face, and body too. Avita, Concept, Salon, and Spa. All you have to do is sit back and say, ah. Mystic Roots can make your dreams come true. What could be better than a whole new you? What'll they say when you walk through? Ooh, ah, ooh, la, la, la.
Mystic Roots, Aveda Concept Salon and Spa, 287 Division Street, across from the United Church.
We're listening to It's a Wonderful Life on Northumberland 89.7, your truly local radio station. We'll be right back after these few messages. Northumberland 89.7, truly local radio, now takes you back to the Fire Hall Theater and It's a Wonderful Life.
And now, Act 2 of the Small Town Theater Radio presentation of It's a Wonderful Life. In heaven, the Superintendent of Angels is still reviewing George Bailey's case history. Clarence, an apprentice angel, is eager to depart for his mission to Earth.
Goodness, boss, I've heard enough. If George Bailey's contemplating suicide, I'd better head down to Earth right away.
Hold it, Clarence. We're not anywhere near the point where George Bailey is thinking of ending his life.
What? Why not?
Oh, you'll never earn your wings if you can't learn to be patient. Now, where were we?
Oh, George and Mary were heading out of town on their honeymoon when they ran into a run. Bank run, I mean.
Oh, yes. It was the financial panic of 1932. You see, bank troubles were very prevalent back then.
Oh, what's going on, boss?
In the lobby of the building and loan, dozens of worried shareholders were clamoring for their savings. Meanwhile, George found Uncle Billy in his office.
What is this, Uncle Billy? I saw a line of people outside the bank, but what's with the angry crowd in our lobby?
It's a panic, George. They want to withdraw their shares.
Oh, they want their money.
But we're in a pickle. The bank called on our loan this morning.
Our loan?
Ah! Uh-oh!
Shut up, Jimmy!
Forget the bird. The bank called in our loan?
Well, they got a run and they needed the cash, so they demanded that we pay off our loan immediately. I handed over all of our cash. I had to.
You handed over all our cash, but that means...
The whole town's gone nuts, George. Now we're in the same pickle as the bank. Who'd have thought you couldn't trust the American banking system? Hello, Bailey Building and Loan? What? Potter? George, it's Henry Potter.
For me? George Bailey here.
George, are you okay? Have you called the police to quell that unruly crowd in your lobby?
The police? Now, why would we need...
I just want you to know that in this financial crisis, I'm here to help.
Help?
Yes. I've just guaranteed sufficient funds to the bank. They will close down for a week's holiday, then reopen.
Potter just took over the bank. I see, and they'll reopen under new management, of course.
Of course. Now, this may cost me a fortune, but I'm willing to help out your shareholders, too. If they need cash, they can sell their shares to me. I'm paying 50 cents on the dollar.
Oh, no, they won't. There'll be no fire sale here. We don't need your bailout.
Ha! You don't have any cash, and you know it. That means bankruptcy. And your working people will lose everything. Am I wrong? I know your charter. If you close your doors before 6 p.m., you'll never reopen.
Well, you don't miss a trick, do you, Potter? Well, here's one you will. Oh, shut up, Jimmy!
Well, George, I guess you told him.
Yeah, Uncle Billy, but he's right. Our charter requires we stay open until 6 p.m. I mean, if we don't, the state can take our license away.
Stay open till 6 without any money? It'll take a miracle.
Oh, come on. Let's see about that crowd out there. Okay, hold on now, please. Now, please, everybody, don't panic. I know you want your money. Yeah, now look, I just talked with Mr. Potter on the phone. He says the bank will reopen next week. Next week!
We want our money now, George. Where's our money?
Come on, everybody. Wait, just a minute. Now listen here. Come on. You've got it all wrong. Your money isn't here. Now, just a minute. Let me explain. Your money's not here. It's not in the safe. No, the money you've invested in this building and loan was put into people's houses. It's in Ernie's house and the Grimaldi's house and your house and 100 other houses.
That's how the building and loan works. If you all want your money now, what do you want us to do? Foreclose on them? Kick them out of their homes?
I don't care. I got $242 in shares here. $242 won't break you. Close my account. I want my money now.
Okay. We'll sign this form and you'll get your money in 60 days.
What do you mean, 60 days?
Well, that's what you all agreed to when you bought your shares.
I got my money. Old man Potter will pay you 50 cents on the dollar for your shares.
Now what do you say, George?
Well, now we have to stick to the agreement.
Oh, yeah? Come on, everybody. Let's take our shares to Potter. Half is better than nothing.
No, wait. Come on. Please, folks. Don't... Hey, now stop! Now listen. If Potter gets a hold of the building and loan, there won't be a decent house built in this town again. I mean, can't you see? He's just taken over the bank. He's already got the bus line, the department store, and now he's after us. And you know why? Because we're cutting into his business. He wants to keep you living in his shacks and paying the rent he decides.
But George...
Eddie, last year things were tough for you. You couldn't always pay, right? Do you think Potter would have let you keep your house?
Well...
Now listen, everybody. Potter is buying because you're panicking and he's not. To him, you're just a bunch of bargains. Now, we can get through this, but only if we stick together. We've got to believe in one another. Have faith.
That's a lot of fine talk, George, but I got doctor bills to pay.
Well,
I... My husband got laid off. We need our money.
Yeah, what do we live on until the bank reopens?
You can't feed your kids on faith.
George, darling.
Oh, Mary, hey.
How much do they need? We still's got some money.
We do? Oh, yes, we do.
The honeymoon money.
Oh, wait, folks, I've got $2,000 here, my own money.
Well, that could last us till the bank reopens.
Oh, I hope so, Uncle Billy. Sure would have made a nice honeymoon.
Bought some furniture, too.
Okay, so we've got some cash. All right, Charlie, how much do you need?
$242.
Oh, come on, Charlie. How about just enough to tide you over?
I want my $242.
Okay. Uncle Billy, give Charlie here $242.
That closes my account,
though. No, that doesn't close your
account. It's just a loan, Charlie. Just a loan.
Okay, all right. Eddie, now.
Well, I got $300 in you.
Oh, but come on, Eddie. How much do you need?
Well, $20, then.
Oh, thank you, Eddie. Thank you. Okay. Mrs. Davis, how about you?
But this is your own money, George.
That's okay. What do you need?
Well, would $17.40 be too much?
$17.40. Bless you, dear. Pay it back when you can. Now, when you can. Okay. Who's next? Now, let's try to spread it out. Spread it out if you can.
Look at the clock, George. Look.
Oh, I'm looking, Uncle Billy. I'm looking. 5 seconds. 4 seconds.
Three, two, one.
6 o'clock. We made it.
Oh, lock the door, Eunice. Lock that door.
Right, George.
Oh, still in business, Uncle Billy, even if we only got $2 left.
Well, maybe they'll breed in the safe, eh, Eunice?
Yeah, like bunnies.
No, they better.
George, telephone.
Okay, Tilly. By the way, call my wife, will you? I forgot all about...
Mrs. Bailey's on the line.
No, I don't want Mrs. Bailey. I want Mrs. Bailey. Wait, Miss... Okay, right. That is my wife. Give me the phone already, will you? Hello, is this Mrs. Bailey?
Yes, this is Mrs. Bailey.
Oh, Mary, we survived. I'm sorry.
Now that you're done saving things, come home.
Huh?
Come home.
Come home? What home?
Our home.
What?
Our home, George, at 320 Sycamore.
320 Sycamore? Huh? Whose home is that?
Our home.
Huh?
Our home, Saphead.
Oh, but Mary, how can we have a...
Right now.
Right now? Okay, sure. All right, sure.
I love you.
I love you too, honey. I'm coming home.
Do you know where 320 Sycamore was?
His mother-in-law's house.
No, it was the old Granville house where George and Mary threw rocks and made wishes. You see, her wish was to marry George and live in the Granville house, and that's where they honeymooned. That's where they set up house, and that's where they were still living. 2 years later, when Mr. Potter asked George to drop by his office.
Now, George, I suppose you're wondering why you're here.
I have no idea, Mr. Potter, but I'm sure you do.
That's what I admire about you, George. You're like me. You get right to the point. Okay. Well, George, I give up.
What? Giving up?
Yes. As you know, I run nearly everything in this town. Everything except the Bailey building and loan, of course. I've tried to gain control of it for years. But you've outwitted me, evaded me, defeated me. Am I right?
Well, actually, yes.
That's because you're a smart man, George. 2 years ago, during the bank panic, you and I were the only ones who kept our heads. You saved the building and loan, and I saved everything else.
Well, most would say you stole everything else.
Envious people might say that, George. The suckers might say that. But we both know that I was just being a smart businessman. And that's what I'm being right now.
So you're giving up?
Well, if you can't beat them, join them.
What? If you're suggesting that we...
Wait, George, don't get up. Don't leave. Take it easy now. I've told you my side of the story. But let's hear your side.
What?
Your side. Now, you're a young man, 27, 28, married, making, what, $40 a week?
45.
Okay, 45. And if you were a common, ordinary yokel, I'd say you're doing well. However, you're no common, ordinary yokel, son. You're an intelligent, resourceful, ambitious young man who hates his job. Yes. You hate the building and loan almost as much as I do, George. You've been dying to get out of this town ever since you were born. You see your friends, your brothers, go places. Why, you're trapped here. Trapped into frittering away your life, playing nursemaid to a lot of garlic eaters. Is this the correct picture, George? Or do I exaggerate?
So, what is your point, Mr. Potter?
My point is, I want to hire you, George.
Hire me? To do what?
To manage my affairs, oversee my properties, and I can start you off at $20,000 a year.
$20,000 a year?
Of course. And you're worth it, too. Wouldn't you like to live in the best house in town? Get your wife some fine clothes? A trip to Europe every year?
Europe? Are you sure you're talking to me? I'm George Bailey. Remember me, the building and loan George Bailey?
Yes. The George Bailey, whose ship has just come in, provided he has the brains to climb aboard.
Yes, but what about the building and loan?
Forget the building and loan. I'm offering you a 3-year contract at $20,000 a year. Do we have a deal or not?
Well, $20,000, a nice home, Europe. Can you give me 24 hours to think about it, ask my wife?
Of course, George. Meanwhile, I'll draw up the papers. Let's shake on it, my boy.
Okay, Mr. Potter. Gee, I never thought I would have...
What? Is something wrong, George? What, just shaking hands over a business...
No, I can't do it. I don't need 24 hours. I know right now the answer is no.
What?
But if you offered me $1 million to stay in Bedford Falls, to be your stooge, the answer would still be no.
But why?
Because the whole world shouldn't revolve around you and your money. Some things can't be bought or bought off, and I'm one of them. I don't need you or your money. Now let me out of here.
You'll eat those words, George Bailey. You're a failure, just like your father. You just don't know it yet.
Sorry I'm so late, Mary. What are you bored waiting up for me?
Just knitting, George. So what did Mr. Potter want to see you about?
Oh, nothing really. Just talk, you know? Oh, jeez, why did you marry a guy like me anyway?
Well, I didn't want to be an old maid.
But I was going to see the world. I was going to go places, build things. I was going to give you the moon. But instead, what have I given you, huh? No nice house, no fine clothes, no trip to Europe. Some husband I am. I feel terrible.
Me too. Mornings especially.
I mean, you could have married somebody successful. You know, somebody like Sam Wainwright. I mean, anybody else.
But I didn't want anybody else. I wanted my baby to look like you.
Didn't even get a honeymoon. No fancy... What do you want to look like me?
My baby.
Baby? What? You mean... Hey, Mary, you mean you're on the nest?
Forgot!
Potter baby, a boy they named Petey.
Oh, that's nice.
And then another, a girl named Janie.
Oh, good for them.
But of course, George never got out of Bedford Falls.
He didn't.
No. Year after year, George slaved away at the building and loan, helping folks like Mrs. Martini move into their own homes in the development, Bailey Park. George kept on dreaming and hoping. Mary had another baby, a girl named Susan, who they nicknamed Zuzu.
Oh, how charming.
Then came the war. Mary ran the USO and had another boy, Tommy. Uncle Billy and Gower sold war bonds. Old Mr. Potter headed the draft board, of course. Violet joined the waves until they found out her way of raising morale would sink the Navy.
Oh, my.
Bert the cop got wounded in Tunisia and received the Silver Star. Ernie the cab driver was captured by the Nazis and escaped from a prison camp. And George's brother Harry, remember him?
Yes, he moved to Buffalo.
Yes, he did. But Harry became a real hero. As a Navy flyer, he shot down 15 planes, two of them just as they were about to crash into a ship full of soldiers.
And George, what did George do in the war?
Well, George fought the Battle of Bedford Falls. He was designated 4F due to his bad ear. So he served as an air raid warden, ran the scrap drives, rubber drives, plastic drives. And like the rest of the country, on VE Day, he wept and prayed. And on VJ Day, he wept and prayed again.
Well, then, we're just about up to today, aren't we, boss?
Yes. The only thing you don't know about George Bailey is what happened that has him down there at this moment, wanting to die.
Suicide. Well, what is it, boss?
All right. Today is the day before Christmas, and in addition to holiday preparations, George is very excited.
Well, Tilly, Eunice, did you see this in the newspaper? Commander Harriet Bailey, famous Navy ace, decorated by President. My brother, the Medal of Honor.
Gosh, George, that's just swell.
Shut up, Jimmy.
Commander Bailey downed 15 enemy planes. The last, a kamikaze, just as it was about to dive into a troop transport. I mean, think of it. Harry saved hundreds of lives. Hey, where's Uncle Billy, Eunice?
Well, he's at the bank, George.
But the bank examiner's here waiting for him.
Oh, well, good afternoon.
Carter, bank examiner.
Yes, of course. Hey, you know what? My brother's picture's here in the paper. The president is decorating him today.
Yes, well, I suppose they do that sort of thing. Now, about the books.
George.
Oh, Violet, how are you? Did you see the paper all about Harry's homecoming?
Can I see you a minute, please, George? Privately?
Privately? Okay, Vi, we can just...
Mr. Bailey, I'd like to finish your audit tonight so I can get home to Elmira and spend Christmas with my family.
Oh, yes, that's right. I just have to... Tilly, show the books to...
Carter, bank examiner?
Of course. Can you, Tilly?
Sure, George. I'll bring them into the conference room. Come right this way,
Carter.
Bank examiner!
Shut up, Jimmy.
Violet, step into my office.
Thanks, George.
So what can I do for you, Vi?
That letter you promised.
Letter? Oh, yes, the letter of recommendation. I was right in the middle of typing it when all this stuff about Harry came up.
Like I told you on the phone, George, I'm leaving for New York. I gotta make a fresh start.
Sure, here. How's this? To whom it may concern... The bear, Miss Violet Bick, has been employed here at Bailey Building and Loan for the past 2 years.
That's lying, George.
Now, Vi. She demonstrated intelligence.
A lie.
Ability.
A lie.
And good character.
Good character? If I had any character,
I'm happy to give her my wholehearted endorsement.
Gee, thanks, George.
Well, come on now. Takes a lot of character to leave your hometown, start somewhere new. And here's something to help you get started.
Oh, no, George, I can't take that.
Oh, come on, you're broke, aren't you? You want to hawk your furs in that hat? Walk to New York? It's a loan, Violet, that's all. I'm in the loan business. Besides, you'll get a job.
Yeah, sure.
Well, good luck, Vi.
I'm glad to know you, George Bailey. Merry Christmas, Georgie.
Well, the same to you, Vi. Say hello to New York.
Shut up, Jimmy.
Ah! Shut up!
Eunice, where's that Uncle Billy?
He's making a deposit at the bank.
At the bank! At the bank! Shut up, Jimmy!
Well, well, Mr. Potter, here to personally guard your money? What, your vault not big enough?
Look out, Bailey, you old fool. My wheelchair.
Did you see the news? Harry Bailey gets Medal of Honor. What do those Bailey boys do next?
Huh. Let me see that newspaper.
Sure, here.
What does that slacker George think about Harry being decorated?
Well, if that slacker had gone, he'd have earned 2 Medals of Honor.
Ah, but George didn't go. Bad ear. He heard everything but the call to arms.
Well, make sure to read the part about the parade for Harry tomorrow. Sorry I can't chat more, you old thief. I gotta go make a deposit.
Next customer, please.
Well, hello. Let's see here. Here you go. Bank book, a deposit slip, and a Merry Christmas to you.
To you too, Mr. Bailey. But haven't you forgotten something?
I forget things all the time.
So, Mr. Bailey, where's the money?
What?
You want to make a deposit, don't you?
Of course. I want to deposit $8,000.
Well, then, it's customary to bring the money with you.
The money? The money? It's gone. Where did I put that money? I know I had it. Where,
God, weave me out of here.
Oh, gosh.
Because the envelope with the $8,000 was folded up in that newspaper he gave to Mr. Potter.
The money was in the newspaper? So that's why George and Uncle Billy are scouring the street.
I'll look by the curb, Uncle Billy. I'll look by the mailbox.
I just don't know what happened, George. I just don't know.
$8,000, not our money. No, the depositor's money. And the bank examiner's here.
But George, we traced every step that I took.
Well, if you didn't drop it, maybe you never put the envelope in your pocket in the first
place. Maybe, but oh, I'm no good to you, George. I'm no good.
Oh, come on, you've got to think. Think.
I can't. I just can't.
Oh, now, where's that money, you old fool? This means bankruptcy, scandal, prison. One of us is going to jail. Well, it won't be me. Now, you keep looking. You hear? I'm going home.
George.
Well, how can I with Janie banging on the piano? Does she have to keep playing that over and over again?
I gotta practice for the Christmas party, Daddy!
What is it, dear? Another hectic day.
Oh, yeah, a red letter day for the Baileys.
Mom, here's Zuzu's plate. Hey, Dad.
Not now, Petey.
The Browns next door got a brand new car. You should see it.
Well, what's the matter with our car? Not good enough for you?
Sorry, Dad. I only...
Thanks for bringing Zuzu's plate, dear. All right, run along now.
Okay, I'll finish on the decorations.
Zuzu's eating in her room. What's the matter with her?
Oh, she caught a little cold coming home from school. Didn't button up her coat. She got a flower as a prize and didn't want to crush it.
What do you mean, a little cold?
It's okay, dear. The doctor said there was nothing serious.
The doctors came?
Zuzu's got a little temperature. Just 99.
What? It's this drafty old house. It's a wonder we don't all have pneumonia.
George?
I mean, why did we live here in the first place? Why in this crummy little town?
What is wrong, dear?
Oh, everything's wrong. I mean, why did we have to have all these kids anyway?
Daddy, how do you spell frankincense?
Well, I don't know. Ask your mother.
Where are you going, George?
To see Zuzu.
Daddy!
Are you okay, Zuzu? I heard you got a cold.
I want a flower at school, Daddy. Can you give it a drink of water?
Drink of... Okay.
Daddy, you crushed it.
Oh, well, I didn't mean to. I was just...
Fix it, Daddy. Paste it.
There. See, it's all pasted. Good as new.
Thank you, Daddy. You can do anything.
Anything? Now try to get some sleep, darling. You'll get better.
Merry Christmas, Daddy.
Mary, Zuzu felt a bit hot to me. Maybe we...
Hello? Oh, thank you, Mrs. Welsh. Oh, she'll be all right.
Well, who is it, Mary?
It's Mrs. Welsh, Zuzu's teacher. What? Oh, well, the doctor said she'd be out of bed in time.
Mary, give me that phone.
George, please.
Is this Mrs. Welsh? Well, this is Mr. Bailey. Now, what kind of teacher are you? Do you realize she could get pneumonia because of you?
George!
Silly, careless people like you, sending kids home half naked. You know, maybe my kids aren't the best dressed kids in town, but at least... hello? Hello! Janie, enough with the piano. Cut it out. Stop!
George, whatever's wrong with you, must you torture the children too?
Okay, then how about this?
You worked for months on that bridge model.
Yeah, happy now?
What has come over you? You are acting like a wild...
I'm sorry, Janie. I'm sorry, Mary.
George!
I've just got to get out of here.
So that's what this sudden visit is about, George. You're $8,000 short in your accounts.
Well, that's right, Mr. Potter, but you gotta help me. I'll pay any sort of interest. If you still want the Bailey building and loan, I guess we could arrange
something.
But
you said the money was lost. What if it was stolen? Maybe you should notify the police.
No, sir. You see, Harry's homecoming is tomorrow, and while the publicity...
I see. You didn't lose the money playing the market, did you, George? Horses?
Of course not, Mr. Potter. The money's
a
just...
A woman, then. Half the town's talking about you giving money to Violet Beak.
No. Well, that has nothing to do with...
So you've come to me. Why not your buddy, Sam Wainwright?
Well, I tried to get a hold of him, but he's in Europe right now.
And so you want a loan from me for $8,000. What do you have as collateral, George?
Well, I have some life insurance here.
Life insurance. For how much?
It's a $15,000 policy. It's
$15,000. But what's your equity in it?
$500.
And you want an emergency loan on Christmas Eve for $8,000?
Yes.
You're pathetic, George Bailey. For years you've opposed my plans, derided my character. You said you didn't need me or my money, did you not?
Yes, sir.
And now, suddenly, I'm very important to you. Well, do I look like Santa Claus?
No, Mr. Potter,
You dreamed of conquering the world. You once called me a warped, frustrated old man. Well, George Bailey, what are you but a warped, frustrated young man? Look at you now, crawling to me for help. Go to that riffraff you love so well. Go beg them for help.
Please, Mr. Potter, I don't know what I'm going to do.
I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to swear out a warrant for your arrest.
Oh, wait a minute, Mr. Potter.
I'm calling the sheriff, and then the district attorney, and then the newspaper.
The sheriff, the newspaper? What about a loan on my insurance policy?
For $500 in equity? George, you're worth more dead than alive.
No, I've got to get out of here.
Where are you going, George? You can't hide in a small town like this. Hello, Sheriff Baxter. This is Henry Potter. I want to report embezzlement at the Bailey Mill.
Oh, Boston, none of that Henry Potter.
Yes, Clarence. He has George's $8,000 sitting in his desk drawer.
What will George do now, boss? Where is he?
Well, he's at Martini's Tavern. George has had a couple of drinks. He's dazed, just standing there.
Our Father, who art in heaven. Oh, God, I've never been a praying man, but if you are listening, show me the way, please. I'm lost, God, lost, please.
Mr. Bailey, you all right? Mrs. Martini, George, he don't look so good.
You right, Nick. Mr. Bailey, you drinking too much, too much. You had enough, please.
Bailey? Which Bailey are you talking about?
This Mr. Bailey, Mr. George Bailey.
George Bailey? Why you? Serves you right, Bailey. If you ever talk to my wife that way again, you'll get it even worse.
Huh?
Ain't it enough she slaves away teaching your stupid kids how to read and write? Then you gotta bawl her out on the phone? She cried for over an hour, you louse.
Hey! Beat it, Mr. Welch. You punch my best friend. He helped me buy my house. Out of here, go! Throw him out, Nick.
Go on, Welsh. Never mind the tab.
All right, I'm going.
Mr. Bailey, how you doing?
Oh, Mrs. Martini, who was that?
That's Mr. Welch.
Oh, well, that's what I get for praying. Where's my policy?
Huh?
My insurance policy.
Don't you worry, Mr. Bailey. Welch, don't come here no more. Wait, Mr. Bailey, I get something cold for your face. Look, the blood.
No, that's all right.
Please, don't go, Mr. Bailey. Stay.
Go on, just let me be.
Stay here, Mr. Bailey. It's snowing. Nick, take Mr. Bailey home.
No, let me alone. Alone, you hear?
Well, Clarence, George left Martini's tavern a few minutes ago. He's standing on the toll bridge, looking down at the river. Do you have your plan ready?
I don't know, boss.
Well, if you can save George with your plan, you'll get your wings.
My wings? Oh, yes, my wings. I won't let you down, boss. George? George Bailey? George? Get away from that bridge, George! Don't jump! George, stop!
We'll return in just a moment to the Small Town Radio Theater presentation of It's a Wonderful Life. But first, a word from LeClaire's Butcher Shop.
LeClaire's Butcher Shop for all of your holiday entertaining needs. Don't forget to order your Christmas turkey soon from LeClaire's Butcher Shop, 365 Westwood Drive.
Bum, 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 you say LeClerc's, we say LeClaire's. However you pronounce it, we don't care. Where you...
Never.
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 You're listening to Northumberland Live on Northumberland 89.7, truly local radio. We'll return in just a few minutes for the final conclusion of It's a Wonderful Life, recorded at the Fire Hall Theater, being presented by the Northumberland Players. We'll be right back.
And now, the thrilling conclusion of the Small Town Radio Theater presentation of It's a Wonderful Life. A troubled George Bailey stands on the Bedford Falls toll bridge, convinced that he's worth more dead than alive. Deep in despair, George stares at the freezing waters below, poised to end it all, when suddenly...
Help! Help me! I'm drowning! Drowning! Help!
Oh my God! Wait, mister, here I come!
Yous two are sure lucky my toll booth is open tonight. Otherwise, you'd have froze to death jumping in a river like that. Are you warming up now?
Well, I'm okay. And you, mister?
Clarence, I'm fine. Although my underwear is a bit out of fashion. I passed away in it.
You passed what?
And Tom Sawyer's trying out, too.
The name's George.
No, my book. I still had Tom Sawyer with me. But you know, George, there is a Tom Sawyer quality to you. Lots of ideas, wanderlust, you know.
So how'd you fall in the river?
Fall in? I didn't fall in. I jumped in. Jumped in to save you, George.
You jumped in to save me?
Well, it worked, right? You didn't go through with your plan, did you?
Go through with what plan?
Well, you know. Suicide?
Hey, there's no committing suicide around here. I think it's against the law.
Well, it is where I come from.
And where do you come from, mister?
Oh, you know. Heaven.
What?
Right.
George, your lip, you're bleeding.
Oh, that. Well, I got punched in the face in answer to a prayer.
No, George, I'm the answer to your prayer. I was sent down from heaven to help you.
Oh, come on.
I'm Clarence Oddbody, AS2.
Oh, AS2?
You know, Angel second class.
Angel, right. Well, I'm going to go see if any other angels just saved somebody. When your clothes are dry, feel free to leave.
Well, thank you so much for the warm stove.
Now, wait a minute. Now, why did you save me?
Because killing yourself is a sin, especially for
$8,000. $8,000? How in the world?
Well, I know all about you, George Bailey. Remember, guardian angel.
Uh-huh. And you're just the kind of angel I'd get. Angel, huh? Well, where are your wings, then?
I'm an angel second class, George. I haven't won my wings yet. But you can help me earn them by letting me help you.
Help me? Oh, okay. You couldn't help me with, say, $8,000, could you?
Oh, we don't use money in heaven.
Oh, well, it sure comes in handy down here, Bob.
Well, some may say so, but...
You know, I just found out a little late, but since you know so much, did you know I'm worth more dead than alive?
Oh, don't talk that way, George. I'll never get my wings if you keep that up. You just don't realize what you've done for people. I mean, if it hadn't been for you...
Well, if it hadn't been for me, they'd all be better off. My wife, kids, my friends...
But killing yourself wouldn't make them happier.
Well, I suppose you're right. I guess it would be better if I hadn't been born in the first place.
What?
Yeah, I wish I'd never been born.
Oh, that's a good one, George.
A good what?
The plan you just gave me. It reminds me of Tom Sawyer. Well, let me see.
What the?
Okay, George, you got your wish. You were never born.
Never born?
That's right. You have no worries, no missing $8,000, no sheriff or Mr. Potter on your trail. You don't exist.
Wait. Wait, my ear. Say something in my bad ear.
You hear me, all right. You don't have a bad ear. That's because you're not the George Bailey you used to be. Now you're, nobody.
Oh, well, that's nuts. But I can't hear.
And your lips stopped bleeding.
Well, hey, it did. What's happening? Oh, I need a drink. Yeah, that's what. How about you, Angel? Want to join me for a drink?
A drink? Well, I'm on duty.
Oh, join me. As soon as our clothes are dry, we can just head on.
The clothes are dry, George. They never got wet, you see.
Okay. Okay, so let's dress and walk over to Martini's Tavern and have a... Oh, I'm sorry. I mean, I'll walk. You can fly.
Oh, fly. I don't have my wings.
Wings, right. You don't have your wings. Well, after a few drinks, we'll both be flying. Come on.
What'll it be, fellas?
Oh, Nick, is Miss Martini still here? I want to apologize.
You want a martini or are you a wise guy?
No. Okay, just give me a double bourbon. Then.
And for you?
Clarence is the name. I'd just love a flaming rum. No. Maybe a mulled wine.
A mulled what?
Yes, with a dollop of nutmeg and just a dash of cloves. Hop to it, my lively lad.
Listen, Clarence, we serve hard liquor here for men who want to get drunk quick. If that's not good enough for you, perhaps I could convince you otherwise.
That's okay, Nick. Just give him the same as me.
Two double bourbons.
Now, why is Nick acting that way? What's going on here? The tavern's all changed.
Bedford Falls has changed. You got your wish, George. You were never born. It's a different world without you.
A different world?
Ah, good. At least somebody just made it.
Well, just made what, Clarence?
Here your drinks.
Every time a bell rings, an angel gets his wings.
What did you say? Angel?
Angel second class.
Clarence, you don't want to talk about angels in here.
Why, they don't believe in angels?
Oh, sure, they believe in them, but...
Is there a surprise to actually see one?
In a bar? Yeah.
Sorry, Nick, you just never grew up.
Sure I did. Next September, I'll be 293.
Don't bit, Caesar. I bet you don't got any money either.
Of course not. We don't use money in heaven.
Well, this ain't heaven. That's enough. Out. Out. Get out of my bar.
Your bar? Where's Mrs. Martini, Nick?
You ain't getting no martini. And how do you know my name anyway? I don't know you from Adam. Hey, you again.
Spare some change, sir? Spare some change?
Oh, no, Rummy. I told you never to panhandle in here.
But Mr. Gower, listen, you know me. I'm George Bailey. George Bailey.
Buy me a drink, huh, mister? Just one drink.
Get out, Gower. Bill, throw that rummy out.
No.
But that's Mr. Gower from the pharmacy.
Yeah, well, that rumhead did 20 years in prison for poisoning a kid. And if you know him, maybe you're a jailbird too. Bill, get these two out of here. Out!
Hey, you don't have to be so brusque.
Hey, everybody, get me. I'm handing out wings.
Well, what happened to Mr. Gower? How can that be poisoning a kid?
Don't you see, George? You weren't there to stop Gower from putting the poison.
I wasn't there. Sure I was there.
No, because you were not born.
Not born? Well, who am I then?
Nobody. You have no identity.
Well, what do you mean? I'm George Bailey.
No, you're not, George. No papers, no driver's license, no 4F card, no insurance policy.
Well, Zuzu's petals.
They aren't there either. George, you may have put those flower petals in your pocket before, but now you don't exist.
Well, they're gone. Gone? What? Am I a ghost?
You've been given a gift, George, to see the world without you.
Well, you're nuts, and you're driving me nuts, too. I'm going home to my wife and family. Do you hear? Now leave me alone. Officer! Oh, Bert, what's with this sign? Welcome to Pottersville.
What about it? You're in downtown Pottersville.
Pottersville? Where's the building and loan? The Bailey building and loan?
What? That joint closed down years ago. As you can see, it's a pawn shop now.
Oh, but what about the...
Hey, where do you think you're going, Violet?
Hey, get your filthy hands off of me, copper. I am Jack Roll Nobody. That sailor had it coming.
He did, eh? Well, you're coming with me.
I said lay off of me. I know the mayor, the judge, and the chief. I'll have you bounced off the force. You can't touch me.
That's enough out of you. Now get in the wagon.
No.
Wait, Violet. Hey, I know that girl.
Yeah, you and every other wolf in town. Now move along before I run you in, too.
Step on it, Ernie. You gotta get me home. I'm losing my mind.
Uh-huh. So where do you live, bub?
Now cut it out, Ernie. Don't pull that act on me. I live at 320 Sycamore.
320 Sycamore?
Yeah, and hurry. Zuzu's sick.
Whatever you say.
Listen, Ernie, I don't know what's going on here. I'm crazy or something. Maybe had some bad liquor. Just tell me now. Your name's Ernie Bishop, right? You live with your wife and son over in Bailey
what?
Park.
Have you seen my wife?
Seen your wife? Of course I have. At your house 100 times. I built it for you, didn't I?
My wife took the kid and ran away 5 years ago, mister. And I rent one of Potter's shacks. I've never seen you before. So what are you calling me Ernie for?
Okay. I mean, okay. Just keep driving. Mary? Kids? Where is everybody? Petey, Janie, Zuzu, Tommy, where are you?
This is just an abandoned house, George. You don't have a wife or children.
Well, what's happening?
Well, if you don't exist, then your children wouldn't
in
have...
In there, officer! That's him! He's off his rocker!
Hold it, you two! There's the police! Put your hands up!
Bert, wait, it's me!
Take it easy, mister. Come along quiet-like, and we'll get you some help.
Bert, what's happened to you? Look, it's this guy here. He's an angel. He hypnotized me.
Well, I am an angel, but I don't hypnotize. We prefer
to... Uh-huh. Well, I'm taking the both of you. Ow! Hey! But let
go
of me, you!
Now's your chance, George. Run! Oh, hey! You wouldn't beat an old angel, would you? Wait! Boss! Boss, help me! Boss!
Hey! What? Hey, Ernie, where'd the old guy go?
I don't know. He just disappeared.
What about the other one?
He ran south down Sycamore. Come on!
Yeah?
Mother!
Mother? Who are you?
Oh, I'm George. Surely you remember me. George!
George who?
Mother, listen, you gotta help me. Something terrible's happened. Something's happened to everybody. If I can just come in and stay until I get over it, maybe...
Get over what? There are no vacancies. Scram.
But we're family. You know, me, your brother-in-law, Uncle Billy... And...
You know Billy?
Well, sure. I saw him today.
Today? Ha! Billy's locked away in the nut house ever since he lost his business.
Uncle Billy, the nut house? What are you...
The Pottersville nut house. And that's where you belong, too. Now beat it.
Mother, open up, it's me!
Beat it, you! I'm calling the cops. You better run.
Looking at the Bailey Park, George?
Well, you again. Well, where's the housing development? Bailey Park, my dad and I built it right here.
As you can see, it's a cemetery, George.
Cemetery? Where are the houses, the people I knew?
Oh, they're here, George. They're here.
What?
Amidst these tombstones, Martini's buried here. The little Blaine girl, your father and... right next to him.
Harry Bailey, dead?
Your little brother fell through the ice and was drowned at the age of 9.
No, Harry got the Medal of Honor. Harry saved the lives of every man on that transport.
Every man on that transport died, George.
Well, how?
Harry wasn't there to save them because you weren't there to save Harry.
Me?
Strange, isn't it? Each man's life touches so many other lives. You know, George, you really had a wonderful life.
Wonderful.
The kingdom of heaven is spread upon the earth, but men do not see it. Don't you see, George? See what a mistake it would be to throw your life away. Life is the greatest gift.
But all the things I wanted to do.
It's easier to want what you get than to get what you want, George.
But Clarence...
Yes.
What about Mary? Please, where's my wife?
But you don't have a wife.
No, tell me where she is.
You won't like it, George.
Oh, what's become of her? Where's my wife?
Oh, haven't you seen enough, George?
Where is she now? Tell me.
Oh, she never married. She's an old maid.
Oh, maid, where is she? Right now, or do I have to choke it out of you?
Okay, George, okay. The library. She works there, but she's just closing up for the night. She won't be... George, come back. Oh, there must be an easier way to get my wings.
Mary!
I'm sorry, sir. The library's closed.
No, Mary, it's me, George. George, come on, you know me.
No, I don't know you. Excuse me.
Oh, Mary.
Let me go.
No, Mary, I got you. I want you, please.
No, stop. Let me go.
Mary, please, please. Where are the kids? Our kids. I need you. Mary, please.
Let me go. Get away from me. Help, help.
No, Mary, I'm George. George.
Somebody help me. There's a bad man. Help.
Mary, it's me, your husband. No, hey, get out of my way. That's Mary, my wife. Let me go.
No.
Mary, wait. Don't run away.
Help. There's a madman after me. Stop him. Help.
I've got to see her. Mary, please. Where are you?
Here I am, George. So are you going to jump off this bridge again, George?
No, Clarence. I want things back the way they were. Put me back into the world. I want to have been born. I do.
But you'll face scandal and prison again. The newspapers, bankruptcy, disgrace.
Anything. I'll do it gladly. I don't care. Just get me back to my wife and kids, Clarence. I want to live again.
Oh, that's the spirit, George. Don't despair. Always be willing.
Oh, yes. Can you do it? Can you do it for me, Clarence? I want to live again. God, let me live again. Yes, let me live again. Oh, yes, God, I want to live again. Yes, God, please let me live again.
George, what are you doing here?
Huh? Bert? No, stay away. Stay away, officer. Come any closer. Clarence, save me.
What in Sam are you yelling about, George?
What? George? George, Bert, do you know me?
Know you? I've been looking all over town for you, George. Where have you been?
Where have I been? Say it again. I can't hear you.
I'll try the good ear. I said, where have you been?
Why, Bert, I'm alive again. Alive again.
Alive again? Are you all right, George? You know, your mouth's bleeding.
My mouth? Hey, my mouth is bleeding. Look at that blood oozing out of there. What do you know?
Well, it's not that bad, George.
Oh, and hey, Zuzu's petals. I had them in my right pocket. Oh, they're here in my pocket. Oh, hey, Merry Christmas, Bert.
Well, Merry Christmas. Get in the squad car, George. I'll drive you home right after I get back from...
No, I can't wait, Bert. I'm going home. I know the way home. Boy, do I know the way home. Merry Christmas, Bert.
Merry Christmas, George.
Oh, Merry Christmas, Bedford Falls. Oh, how I love this town. Hey, Merry Christmas, old building and loan. Oh, Merry Christmas, Mr. Potter. Merry Christmas, everyone. Mary? What's with the... Oh, reporters, the sheriff, yes. Well, Merry Christmas, reporters, sheriff, and you, Mr...
Carter, bank examiner. Mr. Bailey, your books show a deficit, and...
Yes, I know. $8,000, right?
Precisely, and your disappearance has kept
me... Excuse me, Mr. Bailey, I've got a warrant for your arrest here.
Yes, a warrant, sheriff, jail? Isn't that wonderful? Merry Christmas.
Well, actually, no, it's not so...
Yeah, in a minute, folks. Okay, Mary... Kids, I'm home. Oh, look at this
Daddy.
Marvelous drafty old... Oh, kids!
Daddy, you're home!
Oh, Janie, Petey, Tommy, I love you. So where's your mother?
Oh, looking for you, Daddy, with Uncle Billy. Daddy.
Oh, Zuzu, Merry Christmas, my little ginger snap. How you feeling?
Fine, Daddy. Not a smidge of temperature.
Not a smidge of hallelujah.
George?
Mom, George! Mommy's home, Mommy!
Oh, Mary!
George, where did you go?
Oh, Mary.
Oh, George.
Oh, Mary, I have to touch you, hold you. Oh, you're real, Mary. Oh, you have no idea what happened.
You have no idea what's happened.
Well. George, look what I've got.
Uncle Billy.
Money, George. Bushels of money.
You found the $8,000?
No, George. Mary worked a miracle, didn't you, Mary?
People heard you were in trouble, dear. Your friends, they pitched in to help you.
Oh, Charlie. Mrs. Davis, Mrs. Martini, and Mr. Gower. Oh, Mr. Gower, thank you. Mrs. Thompson, thank you. Ernie, Tom, thank you. I can't believe it. Oh, Eddie.
Well, none of us would have a roof over our heads if it wasn't for you, George.
Oh, thank you.
Here, Georgie. Alone.
Violet, you didn't go?
Nah, I decided to stick around.
Wait, everybody. Here's a cable from Sam Wainwright. It reads, Mr. Gower notified me you needed cash. Stop. My office will advance you up to $25,000. Stop. Hee-haw and Merry Christmas, Sam.
I just don't know what to say. Mother and Harry.
George, Mary called us in Washington. I flew in as fast as I could.
Come on, everybody. A toast.
Yes,
Harry.
A toast to my brother George, the richest man in town. To George.
Daddy, look. See my little bell hanging on the Christmas tree?
Oh, I see it, Zuzu.
I hung it up there all by myself. Could you ring it for me, Daddy?
If I can reach it, dear. Excuse me, Mary.
George, somebody left a book here under the tree. See?
Why, it's The Adventures of Tom Sawyer.
There's an inscription. What does it say?
Dear George, remember no man is a failure who has friends. Thanks for the wings. Love, Clarence.
Clarence?
Very dear friend of mine.
Daddy, Mrs. Welch says, every time a bell rings, an angel gets their wings.
Oh, that's right, Zuzu, that's right. That's right. Thank you, Clarence, thank you. It truly is a wonderful life. Happy landings.
A Wonderful Life, based on Frank Capra's film, was adapted for radio by Tony Palermo. Tune in again next time. This has been a very merry production of the Small Town Radio Theater.
Oh,
You've been listening to It's a Wonderful Life, produced by the Northumberland Players for Small Town Radio, Northumberland 89.7 on your FM dial. My name is Victor Svenningsen. I was a recording engineer, and I thank you for listening. This is Small Town Radio, the heartbeat of our community.